Howdy, 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 and welcome to the Lady Walker Show. I am Lady Walker, and beloved, we have a Jim Dandy of a show in store for you. My guest is a cattle manager. He's a cowboy, yay, cowboy, as well as a rodeo star. All the way from Houston, Mississippi, welcome to the show, Tim Cook. Greetings.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Well, great. It's a plum pleasing pleasure to have you here. So we are going to sup a little tea today and get a chance to know who is Tim Cook. Now, of course, I did say in the opening you are a cattle manager, and we're going to probably go in that order.
Okay.
And what inspired you to become a cattle manager, and what is a cattle manager?
I guess what inspired me, my dad have always made me work, and I just love to work. And I started working from sweet potato field, and from the sweet potato field, I noticed the cow farmers right outside of the sweet potato field. And I got to help them time or two with the cattle, and I love the cattle a way a lot better than I did being in the sweet potato field.
Really? The sweet potato field, okay.
But that's where I was growing up, in the sweet potato field. And when I got my opportunity to go help with the cattle, that's where I went. And I just love being around cattle, horses and cattle. And I, after graduating from high school, I got a job for a fellow who owns a feed store. And he had a bunch of cattle. He put me overseeing his cattle. And years later, I went to work for E4 Cattle Company, owned by Ed Eaton in Oklahoma, Mississippi, which is contain a 3,500 acres of ground there, and they have a big old order by a barn. And what years and years after being working there, I got to become the manager of the farm, which my job is to make sure all the cattle get fed. All the other employees feed the cattle, but my main job is to get up every morning, catch a horse, and tend to the cattle, make sure the health is good.
Oh, you go out there on a horse, yes, to tend to them.
Yes, and I tend to check them on horse. But now, sometimes I'm kind of by myself, and technology done made it a little bit easy.
Really?
Hey, what do? I jump on the four-wheeler, run through them, and check.
Oh, okay. Okay, you don't have to get on the horse anymore.
I don't
anymore.
Have to get on the horse. I still have to get on the horse in order to bring them, to move them from pasture to pasture, or gather them up. But most of the time when I check them, I use a four-wheeler.
And how much land are we talking about?
3,500 acres.
3,500, so mm-hmm. You have to cover all 3,500.
If I got cattle on all of it, I have to cover it all. Yes, ma'am, I do.
Now, what really inspired the cattle? I mean, what is it about the cattle that you really enjoy working with?
No matter what kind of day I'm having, if I done had a bad day at the house or something, when I get up in the morning and go to work, once I get everybody else started, I can catch a horse, I can ride amongst them cattle, and I can sing, I can pray, and I can relieve all the stress, you know, and it just, I feel freedom out there.
Really?
I do, it's great.
But what will you consider to be your most challenging moment as a cattle manager?
Getting my employees to go to work.
Well, I think a lot of, you know, employers can say that.
But that's about, you know, it's some days there, you know, when you work hard to keep your cattle alive, and then it just seems like you're still losing the battle, and that's a bad upset to you right there.
Yeah.
To me, it is.
So looking at it from a seasonal standpoint, you got, you know, the four seasons of the year. How is the winter season with doing the cattle?
To me, the winter season are the best
yeah.
time. In the fall, when the weather's cool, and in the wintertime and beginning of the spring, but summertime is tough. The cattle do not respond well in the heat to the medicine that you have to give them.
Oh, medicine.
Right. That's what I have to do. I have to doctor them, you know. And on my buggy, whatever I'm on that day, I keep all my medicine on there, and I got a gun with a dart that I have to doctor them with.
What? So you know exactly what may be wrong with your cattle?
Well, you know, you got a pretty good, you know, idea. A lot of upper respiratory infection, and pretty much what you have out there, you know, with them type of cattle.
So you got all different kinds, or is it just one kind of cattle?
It's all different kind, but they pretty much all, you know, with them, what we call them turnout cattle, you pretty much gonna have the same problem, you know. And then every now and then you see, you detect something that I can't even come up, you know, find out what it is. And I have to go to my vet.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, you have to go to your vet,
yeah,
huh? So you have to take your cattle to the vet or the vet comes
in? I just have to go
in.
To him for advice.
Oh, okay, for advice.
Yes, ma'am.
So you got a big crew working with you as for your employees.
Yes, ma'am. And, but most of them are attending to the fences and feeding the cattle. And I have one more man working with me as we checking cattle. But when we get ready to gather them up to ship them, I have to go to the barn and get the rest of the crew from the barn that worked at the barn. They'll come down in the morning and help me gather them up. Like last week, we had to gather it every morning. We was up at 4.
4, wow.
Because of the heat.
Okay.
You have to move the cattle so early in the morning before it get hot. If not, they ain't going to move.
Okay.
Once it get
they
hot,
are not, huh?
They ain't going to move, I'm telling you. They will work you to death once they get in that shade.
But do they, well, I know we're human beings, you may say attitude. Can you detect an attitude from them?
Oh, yes.
I'm not doing this. They don't say it, but you know, you can tell.
Yeah, you catch them. You're going to always get them what we call them renegades.
Yeah.
They trying to get away. They trying to get away from you. And okay. A lot of time they do, you know.
They do, so you have to, of course, go.
What we call round up the strays, you know.
Yeah.
We have a day for that.
A day for that, huh?
We have a day to round up the strays.
Yeah, that is good. So we are going to take a break in about a minute or two, and we are going to come back and let you talk a little bit on being a cowboy as well.
Yes,
you know, I don't know. I guess that can be sort of related, being a cattleman or a cattle manager or whatever, and maybe being a cowboy as well. I don't know. They can go hand in hand or something.
A lot.
From that
it's related a lot.
Yeah.
Yes, you leave from one deal to, it's just like you're still in the same deal.
Okay. You know? Now, with being a cattle manager, is this like an 8 to 5 or until?
I wish it was from 8 to 5.
Oh, it's not an 8 to 5.
Like last week, you know, it was from four to eight. And, you know, and sometime by the time when the day's over there, I still got to make sure everything is taken care of and be ready for the next day if we have to pin cattle.
What?
Make sure all the horses.
So you really have to go to bed pretty early.
I wish I could sometime. Most time, early to me is around 11 o'clock at night.
Yes, and even if you have to get up at 4 some mornings.
Yeah, right.
But that's not every morning.
No, that's not every morning. That's just the time of year, which is like we get ready to pin cattle to go to shipping them. And I have to get up at that time, get there, get the crew ready, make sure all the horses caught, so we can be in the pasture about 5:30.
Oh, okay. Wow. Mm-hmm. Interesting. All right. Well, we are coming up on a break, and we will come back and let you talk or tell us about how did you come into being a cowboy.
Yes,
that's
ma'am.
An interesting thing. A cowboy. All right, beloved, we will be right back. My guest is Tim Cook, and he is going to be sharing with us about being a cowboy. Yay! Okay, Mr. Cowboy. Mr. Cowboy Tim. Okay, how did that come about? Now, it's so interesting, and I guess I could say you are a modern day, a present day cowboy, but eons ago, way back when, you know, at least on TV, you know, we didn't see black cowboys, at least some of the cowboy movies that I looked upon, the one that Hollywood portrayed at that time. So, you know, as a youngster growing up, I didn't think that black cowboys existed at all, but evidently they did. Yeah. It's just that Hollywood didn't portray them. So they only portrayed one race.
That's right.
Yes,
that's
but there were black cowboys. So how did you come about being a cowboy?
I guess you could say just growing up being rambunctious, you know?
Yeah.
And it's just something I always wanted to do, and I'll never forget the first rodeo my dad took me to. And I said then, that's what I wanted to do right there. But the first rodeo I went to, I wanted to be a bareback rider, rode the bucking horses.
Oh, okay.
But as I grew
the
up.
The bucking horses.
Yeah, right. They called
them. Oh, that's that thing. That's not the live animal.
Yes, that's the live animal. Called.
Oh, okay.
They call them your saddle bronc or your bareback. And I wanted to ride the bareback. But as I grew up, and I always tried to figure out how would I was going to get this opportunity. And my dad bought a farm, and where we still had to go to school at, it was a fella there, his son was a stock contractor. And I got to hanging out with him, and got to sneaking over to their house, and getting on bulls.
And oh, really? You started? Okay, you and snuck over there.
I got to sneaking over there after school, getting on bulls, and his dad would buy them bulls from the sale and try them out. And who got on? Nobody but me. I was getting on anything he bought, I was getting on them. And I'll never forget the first rodeo I entered. I wound up winning like a third at it. You know, that's the first rodeo I ever, and that Sunday was Memorial Day at where my dad went to church at, and it was a fella that was at the rodeo. He came to the memorial service, and he said, "Man, boy, your son really rode that bull last night."
Oh, wow, okay.
And then my dad came to me, he said, "They say you got on a bull." I said, "Yeah, I did." He said, "Well, if you're gonna continue to do that, you gotta get your own insurance." And it went from there.
Really? So you had to get your own insurance?
Yes, I didn't have to, but that's what he said, you know. They took care of me.
Oh, okay.
Well, the school we was going to, we played football, and after he bought the farm, the school we had to go to didn't have football. So he know it took a lot from us not being able to play football, so he was all for it.
Oh,
know.
And that's how
they have supported me 100%.
Oh, really?
They have. My mom have always been kind of scared to come to the rodeo, but she have been to a few of them. And they have, you know, one.
She's scared.
Oh, yes.
What,
yes.
She afraid she may see you fall and get hurt.
Get hurt, right. And I remember one of them we had right there at Houston in the Coliseum. I got hung up real bad and drug all around the pen before I could get back to my feet. And I'm going to say that was the last one she ever came to.
Wow, that is so scary. Just me thinking about it in my mind's eye.
It's going to happen, you know, and it's just a matter. You're going to get hurt. And it's just a matter how bad. If you get on, I got on bulls for 24 years. I rode the country all over the United States. From the East Coast to the West Coast, North to the
bulls.
South.
Oh my goodness.
Following rodeos, getting on bulls.
You know, of course, I'm pretty sure they put the biggest bulls out there. Maybe they start with the smallest one.
No, back then when I first started rodeoing, your bulls was kind of big bulls. But now they breeding them, they smaller, faster. And they got them breeding.
Wait, that's interesting. They were big bulls then, but now they're breeding them and they are smaller?
They're smaller.
I mean, that's interesting.
Really, reason why you can get more of those smaller bulls on a trailer and they buck just as hard as those big bulls or even harder.
Now, that is interesting too because it lets you know it's not always the biggest thing or the biggest person or whatever.
Exactly.
They can always do the big jobs. You know, you got small people who can do it as well.
Exactly. You know, it's a great sport. And I wouldn't take nothing for it, wouldn't change nothing. If I had to do it all over again, I want to go just the same road that I went down.
In that order.
Because I can leave my house and go any direction I want to go. And if I have trouble on the road, I can stop and I can call somebody that I done rodeo with that can come to my rescue.
Now that is really great because you never know what may, you know, be in your pathway as far as with trouble with your car or whatever.
Right.
Or your truck or something from that standpoint. Now, going back to the cowboy thing itself, you have horses?
I have 20-something bucking horses and I have six using horses that I use on the farm and for my own purpose of catching cattle. I worked for the Chickasaw County Sheriff Department, catching stray cows on the highway and horses. Matter of fact, I got a call yesterday to go to a bean field where somebody had some horses in a bean field. And I had to go up there and try to round them up.
So is that something you ride daily? I mean, even apart from work, even that it's not work related, you got your own horse?
Yes, ma'am. I have my own string of horses.
And you ride them daily or?
Every day I just about catch a horse. I have a horse called at the cow pen for some reason. It's just in case I need him, you know. Because all time you ain't able to do it with a four-wheeler. Sometimes you got to have that horse.
Yes. Have you been in a parade with your horse?
No.
Not yet, huh?
No. Well,
Don't plan on it,
you know, that kind of stuff there. Don't really excite me, but you know, putting me out there in them sticks trying to catch a wild cow or a bull.
Now, so that's exciting.
That's exciting.
So what is it when you look at old shows dealing with cowboys and you see all of that going? Does that excite you now? I mean, you know what it all entails. And
I love to sit there and watch the old westerns.
Yes.
I do. Yeah.
Did you have any question when you became interested in becoming a cowboy or being in the rodeo or whatever? Did you ever wonder where was the black guys? Because there, and you know what I found out? There are also cowgirls. as well. How about that? But okay, let me get back on track and we'll come back to that. But when you would sit there in front of the TV coming up and you would see these Western movies like John Wayne and Roy Rogers and a few other people, maybe Clint Eastwood, and you know, a lot more others. Did you ever at that time desire to, you know, become a cowboy or what?
Not really. The watching the old Western.
Oh, it didn't faze you at that time.
It didn't faze me at that time. I just liked them because one of the reasons, it was horses on there.
Okay.
I love horses, and that's one of the reasons, you know, I watched the old Western, but it never fazed me that, you know, that's what I thought about doing. But, you know, who knows? God only somebody knows what I plan, what he have planned for us, you know.
But of course, like I said before, I didn't see any black cowboys at that time. And I don't know what, maybe you saw them. Maybe the cowboy movies that I was watching, maybe they didn't.
They didn't show them, but I have always done a lot of reading. And I read many, many stories about black cowboys, you know. But it was kind of sad not to see them being you know, on TV, but. Hey,
but they have been there all along.
They were there for real.
Exactly. There, and you may not read it in the history books either.
Right.
History books may have just one little paragraph, maybe, you know, because history books are being rewritten every so often. And maybe one day they may put it in there and maybe they may not. I guess it depends on who does the history books.
Right.
All righty then. We are going to take another break and come back. And we are go down the line of, because I know you attend a rodeo weekly or whatever. We'll talk a little bit about that.
Yes, ma'am.
All righty, beloved. We will be right back. Welcome back, beloved. Cattle manager, cowboy and rodeo star, Tim Cook. Okay, Tim, we are going to find out a little bit about the weekly rodeo that you attend. Tell us about that, how that come about, and how often, I think I said weekly, every weekend, or tell us about that.
Well, the association that I travel in, which would be known now as the PCA, and different more, you know, small association, every weekend you can attend to 2, 3, 4 rodeos. But when I was on the professional level, which was IPRA, a lot of time I would leave on a Wednesday. I start rodeoing on a Thursday, and I would rodeo Thursday, Friday, 2 rodeos Saturday, and 1 Sunday, and head back home, go to work, to that next Wednesday, Thursday, and start all back over. Rodeos are every weekend.
Every weekend.
Every
so
weekend.
It can take you from what state to what state?
You can go however far you want to go. I would leave my house on a Thursday, be in Houston, Texas on a Friday morning, rodeo Friday night, Saturday day I would go to 2 rodeos, Sunday I would go to 2 rodeos within 50 miles of Houston, Texas, and then Sunday night or either Monday morning I would be headed back home.
Yeah, well, how do you prepare for a rodeo, especially doing it that often? How do you prepare yourself body-wise, you know, and mentally-wise?
You just gotta stay fit, take care of yourself the best you can, and just stay prayed up to God, because I'm telling you, it'll take a lot out of you. And you'll see a lot on the road that'll discourage you, and you'll get in different groups. If you ain't in the right group, you can go down the wrong road.
Yeah.
But you know, you stay prayed up with God, hey, it'll all work out.
Now, I know before we started taping, you said something to the fact that the ambulance is always on standby at a rodeo?
Always. Any rodeo or bull riding, the ambulance have to be there on the rodeo grounds.
And you mentioned something that when you first got stepped on by a bull.
Your body can't take that.
Your body can't take it.
That's what you say, you know, you asked me about, most people were worried about the horns.
Yeah, I thought the horn would be the most dangerous
most
thing.
Most people worry about the horns, but I have tucked hookings and hookings and hookings on top of hookings. Get up, crawl over the fence, go to the next rodeo. But I can remember the first time I was in Houma, Louisiana, B-Bar K, Billy Kalinske out of Slaughter, Louisiana, had a bull to step direct center of my chest on the side of my head, pull all the hide off the side of my head,
wow.
Ear, and hair, and I got up. and made it to the out gate. And I never forget, the rodeo clown came to me. He had me on the arm. He said, "Get him in the ambulance." So he got stepped on center chest. I said, "No, I'm all right." And I looked up and I passed out. When I come back through, I was in the ambulance, headed to the hospital.
Well, have you known of anybody who probably was killed, you know, by
that? I do.
And did that discourage you, like, not to get back on?
No, it didn't, you know, but it was just, you had that empty feeling in you, you know. And I can remember one or two occasions where I remember a friend losing their life.
So when that happened to you, did you decide to get back up on a bull again after that happened?
Yes, I was into that rodeo that Friday night in Louisiana, somewhere that Saturday in Georgia, but they dropped me off at the house because I was injured. And they had to go on. We was already running behind because I stayed in the emergency room down early to like 2 o'clock that morning. And my mom got me to our doctor that Saturday. I was supposed to stay there 6 months. My mom and dad went to St. Louis to a family reunion or something. 6 weeks later, I was climbing back on the bull.
Oh, wow. And that did not deter you from, like, okay, I'm not doing this anymore. But, you know, if everybody quit when they fall and get hurt, you know, you probably wouldn't have
no
sport.
Cowboy. That's right.
And that's in just about anything.
That's right. And that's what we always say. Now, when we at a rodeo, if you see a young person that's been going down the road a little bit and he's riding good and he get a pretty bad injury, that's what we'll say. This here is going to make him or break him. Either he coming back or he going to the house.
Yeah.
If he come back, he going to be a tough one.
And a lot of times do they come back?
Oh, if it's in their heart, they going to come back.
Yeah.
If it's in their heart,
now, you said something about a rodeo clown. What's the purpose of a rodeo clown?
Rodeo clown or a bullfighter, whatever you want to call him, he's a lifesaver. He's a lifesaver. He's watching that bull. He knows where to put himself to attract that bull, get that bull attention. Because most of them old bulls, they bad fighters. And if you fall off right there close to him, he get on top of you. But if that bullfighter steps right in there and lead him right away from you.
Really?
They are well.
So how do you train? Did I just ask you, how do you train to even get on a bull? Is it that mechanical bull? Is that how you train?
The first bulls I ever got on was live bull.
Oh, it wasn't that mechanical
bull? It wasn't a mechanical bull, no. Nope. And it's totally different than a mechanical bull and a real bull.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it is, because it's not stepping on you.
A lot of the schools, colleges, they have those mechanical bulls that just kind of get, you know, stay in shape and teach you your fundamentals and your basic. But to really learn, hey, getting on them live bulls.
So at a rodeo, is the mechanical bulls are not there?
No, they're not there. You might have one down on the end for amusement or something like that, just to, you know, crowd, some spectators go down and get on. But for us, you know, when it's a rodeo, it's the real deal.
About how many people participate, you know, as far as being a part of it?
Contestants.
Uh-huh.
You can have anywhere from 20, you can have anywhere from 10 bull riders a night to 25 bull riders a night. And your bull riders would probably be your most contestants at a rodeo.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Size your ropers.
So now, with you being on the road often, does that interfere with your personal life?
No.
As far as wife or girlfriend or whatever?
I was, I guess I can say I was single till I met my last wife, my second marriage.
Okay.
But when I met her, that's what I was doing, rodeo, and she accepted that.
Okay, so she knows what
she knows what my lifestyle was. Okay,
and know that you will be on the road a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But now that you are not doing that, when you go to a rodeo, are you on the? You are no longer on the bulls anymore.
No, I'm no longer. I'm no longer getting on bulls. All I do now is work at the rodeos and steer wrestle.
But you are still gone often.
I'm still gone often.
So she understands that.
Yes. And she used to travel with me. She was my hauling partner. I had another friend that was my hauling partner, and he became a minister. And after that, I was on the road by myself, and she was my hauling partner.
Yeah.
But after I quit getting on bulls, She quit going.
Yeah, any children?
I got four daughters.
Oh, four daughters.
Four daughters. I didn't get no cowboy. Didn't even get a cowgirl.
<You
didn't? laughs> I got ball players.
Oh, interesting. How
I love
about
softball
that?
Softball players, but that's all I got.
Didn't get a cowboy nor cowgirls. They are not interested in it, right?
No, not at all.
Okay,
not
well, we are going to take another break and come back and close it down.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, beloved, we will be right back. Tim Cook, rodeo star, cowboy, and cattle manager. All right, and we got just a little less than 2 minutes. Now, I know you say you all have rodeo weekly, and I guess it may be somewhat a seasonal. It may be pretty big up until a certain point. It sort of winds down or something like that. But if someone is interested in being able to attend a rodeo, how can they find out about that?
You can look on rodeo, go on a rodeo website, and just pull up rodeo and any kind of website that says rodeo, and most time that website will list all your different rodeos from your IPRA, PCA, PRCA, all your different events, associations, and then they'll have a schedule list for each association.
Okay.
And all you have to do, look on there, and if there's one close in your area, attend it.
Okay.
And I guarantee you, you'll enjoy it.
Now, I know you said that you have four girls, and I know you have no cowgirls or no cowboys, you know. So what would you tell a young person, be it a male or a female, who may have that desire now to become a cowboy or a cowgirl? What would you tell them?
First thing I would tell them, get your pen and paper out, write down my number. I'd be glad to give you my number out, and call me, and I can get you hooked up with somebody in your area that I could tell you how to get started rodeoing.
And, yeah.
And I would say, if that's something you want to do, go for it.
Go for it.
Because right. I will tell you, you will love it.
Yeah.
It's a great sport.
It's
meet
a lot
of people. It's a big family. Rodeo is just one big family.
All right. Well, I appreciate you coming out. I mean, all the way from Houston, Mississippi. I have been through that direction, but I appreciate you taking out the time to come out and allow me to interview you on who you are and what you do and how you got there and all of that. Thank you ever, ever, ever so much for that, because time is precious, and I appreciate you coming out.